The other day, I came across a tweet by Sigewitzke, who was happy that finally a bug he reported to Chromium was made public. It is about stealing local file contents by abusing liberal CSS parsing. And when I started reading, I saw the reference to a bug 3 to 4 years ago, which was about a same origin policy bypass for data exfiltration with CSS, which itself references an issue 4.5 years prior to that, with cross-domain thefts via CSS string property injection. So I think this will be super interesting to look at how these evolved historically and relate to each other. It will provide insight into the work of security researchers who built on research before them. You will see how engineers working on Chromium discuss these findings, and generally, you will understand why the web is such a mess and so difficult to secure. Of course, these are not necessarily issues where the general public is interested in. They are not super critical world ending, but they are technically super exciting, and if you are interested in web security, this is the stuff you have to care about. So let's start in 2009. Scary Beast, Chris Evans, he is a well-known security researcher, and at the time he was doing security work at Google. Also, according to LinkedIn, he transitioned to the Chrome security team shortly afterwards. And now he is the head of security at Dropbox. I just find this pretty fascinating to look back at the historical context of this all. So this is a bug reported in the official Chromium bug tracker that everybody can look at. It's not Google internal, though security bugs are usually private for a while until Chromium fixed it. It is super interesting if you are a student or generally have never seen how engineers might work. Anyway, this bug is kind of annoying. The hope is that something can be done at the browser level. We really don't want to have to make sweeping changes to lots of our applications and generally burden web apps with more web browser issues. This affects Chrome, Safari, IE, Opera, and Firefox. The attack involves cross-domain CSS style sheet loading. So this means your website is hosted on example.com and you are including a style sheet from another domain like youtube.com. Because the CSS parser is very lax, it will skip over any amount of preceding and following junk in its quest to find a valid selector. The parser, the thing that interprets CSS files, is looking for CSS in the loaded style sheet. For example, this is valid CSS loading an image. But what would happen if this CSS is included in, for example, a XML document? What would happen if you use that as a style sheet? Then the lax CSS parser will skip the junk. Junk in this case is XML. The CSS parser has no clue what that is. But once it finds the CSS stuff, it will interpret that. As you can see, if the attacker can inject a couple of strings into a trusted response, there is a useful attack here. The data is stolen cross-domain with, for example, window get computed style. This is the crucial part. The title of the issue contains cross-domain theft. You know, you can perform actions on a website, like submitting forms, interacting with an API, loading images, and so forth. And all that is used to implement web applications, such as social networks or mail clients. But the big problem is, websites are not really isolated from each other, right? I can embed an image from another domain. I can load JavaScript from a CDN. So websites are not super strictly isolated. There are weak points where they bleed into each other. Loading an image from another site might not sound very problematic, but imagine if a private image only loads when you are authenticated, and then you visit a malicious site, the site embeds that image, the image loads because you are authenticated with cookies, and then malicious JavaScript takes that loaded image and forwards it to an attacker. That would be all horrifying. Thus, we have the same origin policy that affects a lot of different things. A lot of the very obvious and scary ways you could imagine to access data across origin is protected. But style sheets were always allowed to be loaded. And not only that, you can also use JavaScript with getComputedStyle on an element to get the CSS properties. So even though a style sheet was loaded cross origin, you can indirectly read the content by checking the style on an element it applied. But this doesn't sound too scary, right? There's no secret data in CSS files that is always safe. But who said that you would always load real CSS files? What is a real CSS file anyway? How would the browser or the CSS parser know what you embedded is really a CSS file? And suddenly you open a can of worms. You thought it's all fine and dandy and pretty flowers everywhere, but you notice the scary beast lurking in the field. The web is such a mess with different file types, formats, and stuff that is happening. And the scary beast suggests if you have a XML API, in this example you write a comment for a photo, the comment happens to include partial CSS, and then you embed this XML API as a style sheet on your malicious website, then this is how the parser would interpret it. The CSS parser ignores the junk, finds the body selector, applies the background image to it, which will then trigger a URL load to evil.com, which happens to include the XML data as the URL path. Boom, you stole the secret cross origin. There are a surprising number of places in our products where an attacker could do this. It can apply to HTML, XML, JSON, XHTML, and so forth. The main common construct that prevents exploitation is newlines. You know, a newline in CSS would break the CSS. Obviously, newlines cannot be considered a defense. The exploitable places in Google include some JSON and XML data APIs. And now Chris tries to suggest a way how to fix this directly in the browser. First, when loading cross-domain CSS, we could engage a stricter parsing mode that stops on the first syntactic errors. So it would see XML junk and immediately stop and say, well, invalid CSS, sorry. But browsers really want to make it easy for developers and not complain about small issues. So the second option suggests, let's do the same as one, but only engage when the MIME type is not CSS. Okay. So now we introduce the content type. We could use a lex parser if the MIME type is valid CSS, otherwise we are super strict. That could maybe help against CSS embedded inside of an XML document. You could also do some variation of one or two, but only engage when the content type options no sniff is seen. Won't help most of the internet though. That's a more active measure a security conscious website could do, but it might break sites that don't do it. Or when loading cross-domain CSS, do not send cookies, but that probably breaks the entire internet. Without cookies, the data returned would never be authenticated and thus never contain secrets. But never is not quite true. You could authenticate based on other means, such as internal networks, basically whitelisted IP addresses. But in general, that might break the internet anyway. And then engineers and security people start discussing about solutions. Oh wow, I just noticed what kind of famous people are discussing here. This is Elkan Tuf, who just won the Pony Award for his lifetime achievement, and he's the author of The Tangled Web and so many more awesome things. And Skylined, who I know from his browser exploitation tweets. Option 1 is probably not feasible in the sense that when you set Firefox Error Console to log all messages and browse the web even for a short while or even just use Google services alone, you are going to accumulate an obscene number of CSS syntax warnings. That's why the CSS parser is so lax in the first place. People can't even write error-free CSS. Plus, a parser mode that depends on content origin would be pretty damn counterintuitive and confusing. Yeah, load CSS from your domain or with that header, it is fine, and load it from somewhere else, it breaks. That would be super weird. I can't find it in the archives, but has reading the content from other websites not been around for ages? If I remember correctly, you used to be able to detect and read local files in Microsoft Internet Explorer if they even slightly resemble CSS using the CSS text property. Maybe we can put all the objects associated with the cross-domain stylesheet in the domain of the stylesheet, preventing JavaScript from reading setting properties cross-domain. You may still be able to leak information if it's presented in some very specific form. Properties giving raw access to stylesheet text are restricted in Firefox, i.e. and Opera, not Chrome. I have a separate old bug open for that. I don't think this capability adds too much to this attack. Even with DOM access closed down, there are still the get computed style thingy we could restrict, but still there would be a leak. And the background image URL property causes a fetch to evil.com/blah where the path component blah might be insensitive info. It's super fun to read, but I don't want to waste your time. Oh, would that be a good video? Dramatic reenactment of bug discussions? Of course, to mind comes also abusing the same techniques for other contexts. Is the only reason this doesn't work for JavaScript because the JS parser is much stricter than the CSS parser? What about other parsers like the Flash parser? There are lots of different formats you can load cross-origin and interact with. Yep, and that's why the web is so effed up. Anyway, ultimately they decided to implement this fix. Block style sheet loads if it is a cross-origin load where the MIME type is incorrect and the resource does not start with a valid CSS construct. So let's move from 2009 to 2014. A bug report by my friend and colleague File Descriptor. WebKit Blink allows a page to load an external resource as CSS and will interpret it even if its MIME type is not correct. This allows an attacker to exfiltrate data from cross-origin page via a CSS string property injection with a couple of techniques. And File Descriptor, like us now, knew about the old discussion. The behavior had been discussed before and was patched later. The fix that has been employed is to engage a stricter parsing mode when loading across origin resources with incorrect MIME type. To summarize the observation, we can still import any type of cross-origin resource as CSS and the browser will parse it, but when doing so, a stricter parsing mode for CSS is engaged to stop potential attacks. But you can already see, well okay, it's not always stop. Though the idea to have fully valid CSS when injecting into XML seems pretty unlikely. So there might be still cases where it is still exploitable. WebKit and Blink has adopted the so-called minimal enforcement as defense. The idea of it is that the parser will stop parsing on the first syntactic error. This is effective for most cases. However, there are still possibilities for this attack in extreme cases. The attack limitations are described here. Unfortunately, during my investigation, I discovered a couple of techniques that can make the attack possible in many websites. If we can control the char set of the target as UTF-16, we can bypass most of the limitations, as UTF-16 maps 2 bytes into one character. It wipes out all the ASCII characters in a document. As a result, quotes and lines breaks are eliminated. Moreover, CSS allows Unicode characters in the range of A0 to 10FFF as identifiers, which we can abuse to force the content of a document into valid CSS syntax. To sum up, there are two requirements to perform this attack. First, the target does not have the char set configured in the header, which is very common that it even exists in Google services. And the injection point allows null bytes, because you need that to create valid ASCII characters in UTF-16. For example, the string AB would be null byte A, null byte B. So if your web server with some trusted data doesn't force a char set with an HTTP header, you know the browser has to guess now what the char set of the file is.
So if the site doesn't set the encoding in the response header and you include the null bytes to make it look like UTF-16, the browser will guess that. Or if you have an injection at the start, you can inject FEFF, the bomb, and the browser will ignore the set encoding and you get UTF-16. Now the browser thinks it's UTF-16, thus the whole file becomes random UTF-16 characters, except of course the injections you control, where you then place valid UTF-16 ASCII characters to create a leaking CSS structure.
Super crazy. Browsers are so weird. But the fix is very simple. Browsers should refuse to load cross-origin resources as CSS if its MIME type is incorrect. Alchemtov comments on the issue and says, well, if others are unconditionally breaking cross-origin CSS with bad content type these days, no real harm in matching their behavior. Although we would normally advise anyone to always specify char sets on any responses that contain anything interesting or user controlled, and not doing so really opens up some other attacks, your UTF-16 POC seems reasonably convincing. And after a while, the clusterfuss bot chimes in, uh-oh, this issue is still open and hasn't been updated in the last 7 days. Since this is a serious security vulnerability, we want to make sure progress is happening. And Mike West agrees, we should simply stop loading text HTML as CSS and suck up the compatibility impact. Given that Firefox already goes this route, I would expect lowish risk. 2 months after the initial issue, File Descriptor reports back with, any update? In fact, I have found a real-world scenario where this attack is present. Then they had some issues with trying to fix it because tests after a build were failing, and in June 2015, File Descriptor then got $1,337 for his report. Nice. And then finally, after around half a year, the issue was finally fixed. And this leads us to the bug today by Sygewitzke. So what could possibly still be wrong with this after around 8 years of the initial report? Resources from file, so when you don't load a website via HTTP by the local HTML file, it does not define a content type. Of course, there is no server that would set an expected content type. Hence, a malicious page can load any local resource as CSS, and it will be interpreted as such, independently of the MIME type. This allows to exfiltrate data from cross-origin local files via CSS injection. This is a small variation of File Descriptor's bug. Okay, it makes sense, right? You can load CSS cross-origin, but the parsers were made stricter and you can't really use it anymore with injections to extract data. But he noticed that when not loaded over the internet, but locally, this does not really apply. There are two obvious questions now. First is about how do you get somebody to open a local HTML file? And the other question, how to do injections locally? What the heck? About the first challenge, he writes, the attack requires a victim to render a local malicious HTML page. There are many ways to trick a user into it, force downloads, redirection from local PDF, mail attachments, etc. Furthermore, I guess this can become especially useful in Android or Electron environments. And for the injection parts, there are some clever tricks. Here are a few examples. First, Chrome's SQLite database, which holds your cookies. So you could create a cookie with CSS and then load the cookie SQLite database as a style sheet, and when you are lucky, when the injection is in a good place and none of the other restrictions break it, you can now leak data from the database, steal local file contents. The code above can work sometimes, but with huge files it is hard to control the characters appearing before and after the injection payload, and some of them break the CSS parsing. But there are more examples. There is the current session file, which contains information about the current request and also comes in UTF-16. It also includes iframed requests data, so you could steal content of frameable cross domains. Then there's the local storage, which is placed into the LevelDB folder, so you could steal some local storage data from other sites or extensions. And the cookie monster, a variation of the first idea, but turned to 11. New cookies are most of the time written before older ones, which is great to inject early in the file. We could try again with UTF-16, but cookies do not allow null bytes. But that's when he abuses the encryption of the cookie name. I won't go into exactly the details right now because of the length of the video, but the attack is inspired by padding oracles and the more recent eFail issue. And Gunvael has done an excellent in-depth stream about eFail that I'll link below. If you want to really dig deep, go there and subscribe to his awesome channel in general. So he wants to find a cookie name that, when encrypted, will contain the payload here. As these are just a few bytes to control, this can be brute forced in a few minutes, maybe requires a few billions of AES encryptions. That is such a great attack. Wow. Let's peek quickly at the dev discussion about it. The proposal in number one is unfortunately probably not trivial because the stylesheet code doesn't rely upon network's content type sniffing, which for the file protocol sets the MIME type based on the file extension. The HTTP content type function is literally looking at the content type response header, which isn't set for resources from the file protocol. If we do make a change here, we need to watch out for regressions in Android WebView. It turns out that some Android applications are dropping resources and loading them via extensionless file URIs. God damn, the web is a mess. In the end, the fix was simple. Restrict file stylesheets to .css extensions. And Sygewitzke was awarded $2,000 for his report. And that's how web browser security research works.